how we do on the Al York Sports Show. Get y'all hyped for music real quick. The intro before I bring it in. This is how we do. For the new year, the new decade. Back at it, Al York Sports Show. Another episode coming straight at you from Vegas. Bringing you a 29 and 22 free picks record. 57%. I mean, you can't beat that. Probably the best time of year right now. We got bowl season. NFL playoffs start this weekend. You got the All-Star break coming up in the NBA. You got college basketball in full swing. You got all the off-season moves going in baseball. I mean, even NHL is popping right now. You got everything going on. So we gotta bring it to you. It's gonna be fast and furious, 100 miles an hour, topic after topic. Stick with us the rest of the show until we get to the end when we give out the plays. And don't forget when it's all done to share the video and put it out there because, you know, we're doing this for y'all. Alright, we appreciate all the support. Got my man Al York coming in right now though.
It's good, baby. What up, y'all? Happy New Year. Lorenzo Woods, I see you, baby. Liddy, I see you. Welcome back to a new edition of the Al York Sports Show with Noah Parker, the 2020 edition. We promise y'all, man, we're going to continue to do what we do and also take it to a next level for y'all. Just continue doing what y'all doing, and we're going to do what we doing. Big Iz, a San Francisco 49er dude. I love you, Iz. Thanks for continuing to tune in, and Happy New Year. And yo, bro, before we start this show, I'm going to show everybody that it's nothing to show love. You understand what I'm saying? I keep telling y'all, we're getting older. People dying faster. You got to appreciate your peoples. So I'm going to lead by example by telling my boy right here that I love him in front of all of y'all because it takes nothing to say that, bro. And I appreciate you, brother. Real talk, brother.
Love you too, bro.
I can't believe you said that shit, man. Yeah, so like I said, y'all, it's nothing to tell your peoples you love them because when they die and they in that coffin, why are we going to wait for that? I mean, that's kid shit. It's bullshit. Appreciate your people while they in front of you, man. Life is short and precious. And with that, we're going to start the Al York Sports Show. You gave them the record and everything, correct?
29-22.
Okay, shout out to the East Coast, West Coast, Midwest. Shout out to Syndicate Radio TV, Vegas Divas, One Voice, D Beeman. And also, rest in peace, shout out to my man Corey Bezo from New York. Love you, brother. And I hoped I could have said that before you passed. This is why I'm preaching that now, because I ain't going to miss another friend like that. I'm just not going to let that happen. And also, shout out to Credit Fix. Y'all want to fix your credit, IG me, inbox me, email me at al.newyork@yahoo.com. Fix your credit. And with that, we're going right into the NFL playoff this Saturday. We're going to educate the audience on what they need to do and what they should do. But first things first, the first game is your Buffalo Bills at the Houston Texans this Saturday. The line is -3 for the Texans, 43.5. I'm going to start with the Bills first. What do the Bills have to do to win this game?
Man, they got to act like it's a playoff game. It was in the playoffs a couple years ago. They had Tyrod Taylor, quarterback, played against the Jaguars. Didn't show up, didn't even score. It was just happy to be there. We hadn't been in the playoffs in 18 years. So now we back again. We built a different quarterback, going up against a team that's been to this wild card game time after time. I want to say they lost 5 of the 6 wild card games.
I agree.
You know,
Buffalo Bills, he's repping.
That's my team. Y'all been hearing it since the beginning. But Deshaun Watson's a beast, though. I mean, this is not T.J. Yates coming into play. This isn't Brock Osweiler.
Right. You know,
this is a whole new monster. He has these games where he can beat anybody.
Or call.
Right. Or he has a game where he don't show up. And another thing that came out in the last few days is J.J. Watt, I guess, is apparently playing in this game.
Definitely
now.
Coming back. So huge addition, I mean, to that
huge
defense.
That's scary.
Huge, you know, present for the crowd that's going to be there. Yeah. They're going to go crazy just like they went crazy for Beast Mode and Century
right.
Link.
Yeah, it's a little Willis Reed kind of thing.
Yeah.
When you
yeah.
show up, it's going to be a jolt of electricity to the crowd, to the players, to the fan, everything. So that's, you know, it didn't really move the line or nothing, but I think it opened up at -3.5. So money's been coming in on the Bills. And I don't, you know, it doesn't surprise me at all because that defense is stout. They can stop a Deshaun, you know, Watson offense. I think it's going to be a slug it out, grind it out game.
Real quick, what do the Bills have to do to win?
They just have to, you know, stay in distance. Can't go down two scores. If they stay a score behind with that defense, they can do enough to win that game ultimately. Because I don't see anybody getting blown out. I think it's going to be a close game pretty much the whole way. And I don't want to say whoever has the last possession, but whoever can overcome the other team's defense wins that game.
Right. Does Josh Allen step up to the plate?
We're going
to
find out because he hasn't played in a real big game.
Not that we're going to find out.
He hasn't played in a big game. Okay. So the biggest game he's played was probably the Patriots in the regular season. So
right.
This is
it's yet to be seen.
We haven't seen him. We don't really know what he can bring to the table when it comes to clutch situations in a game of this magnitude with the whole world watching.
Okay, my thing for the Bills to win, they can't get down too much. He actually mentioned that. Can't turn the ball over.
No.
And need to create turnovers. Simple as that. Now we're going to ask the same question for the Houston Texans. What do the Texans have to do to win this Saturday?
I think I have to play a complete game. I mean, you've seen this team lay an egg against garbage teams.
Right.
And then you've seen them come out on Monday Night Football and destroy the world champs and the Patriots.
That's the thing. They're very inconsistent.
It's not consistent.
Remember that big game? And then they, like you just said, they laid an egg. Like, jeez. Denver Broncos almost beat them, too.
Yeah, there was up. Somebody beat them. There was up 31-0 on them earlier this
season. It wasn't Carolina, right?
It was somebody that's not good.
Right. They lay down. We actually had the other side of
that
game.
And that's what's really weird about this team. They're not...
What's up, Gabrielle? What's up, Jackwell?
They're not going to, you know, really be a team that we can you can expect to do something. You don't know what they're going to do.
If they show up,
they can win
the game.
They could beat anybody in the league.
They win the game. So my thing is, Watson has to play big.
Of course.
The addition of Watts, whether he does something or not to change the game, the fact that he's just in there, it's going to motivate that whole defense to a brand new level.
Right.
J.J. Watt, and God forbid if he has a good game.
Yeah, can he cook?
I mean, God forbid if J.J. Watt has a good game and Deshaun Watson does this thing, they will send Buffalo home real early in this game. But I think the Buffalo Bills hang late and they'll lose by probably a field goal or touchdown at most. Okay, now we're going to game two. This is a crucial game here in Foxborough for multiple reasons. But we're going to start with the Titans. The line is -5 for the Patriots. 44.5, what do the Titans have to do to win this game?
Well, the Titans have to play a...
Sound.
I mean, they have to go out and play like this is it. I mean, they've been... Since Mariota got benched, this team's been playing at a whole...
What up, Holly?
They've been balling. Okay? Mm-hmm. This is a...
Tannehill ain't no fluke.
This ain't the same right? Tannehill I remember in Miami. This...
He had flashes over there, but now it ain't flashes. He's actually living up to it.
And the last time Tannehill played against the Patriots was the Miami Miracle, where they went the Hail Mary.
That's a great point.
So I mean, he's seen this team before. It's not like he's never seen this Patriots team before. He's, you know, the way he's playing right now, the weapons they got, especially at running back, they can, you know, easily dominate.
Henry has to have a big game.
Yeah, but.
There's no ifs, buts about it. Has to have a big game.
You can't have a bad quarter in this game because you're in Foxborough in January. And that's all you got to say. Foxborough in January, in the last 20 years, they've been, you know, this team obviously has been almost unbeatable. So they have to not play a perfect game, but they have to play an A-minus, B-plus game to be in position to win this game.
No turnovers by Tannehill, especially in his part of the field.
Right. Don't throw to Gilmore side.
Yeah. Henry has to get going.
Yep.
And a defense got to make stops.
Exactly.
Same question for the Patriots.
Patriots got to wake up. They got to know who they're playing. They're not going up against Mahomes or Jackson. They're going up against Tannehill. They got to understand that they can beat this team. Okay, this isn't a hard playoff game. I don't see them losing this game. Now, obviously, they haven't looked good in the last month.
Right.
Almost 2 months. But if they can channel the energy that they're in Foxborough in January and they want it, and Brady wants another ring before it's over, and Belichick, I mean, they can win this game handily. I can see them winning this game 24-10 type, you know.
Right.
You know, like just a,
don't give it our free picks yet. Right.
I just say I can see them, you know, dominating this game from the beginning to the end because it's in Foxborough, because it's in January. And they got
This is what they live for.
You know, they looked horrible last week blowing the game to the Dolphins. And maybe that woke them up to know that we blew the bye. So we got to play, you know, an extra game now. And it's a wake-up call. So that's the only thing I can say.
Right. Real quick for me. If the Patriots sustain any type of running game, You know, they got to get White going. Mm-hmm. They got to get your boy going.
Sonny Michelle?
Yeah. Michelle has to get going. If they sustain any running game, Brady could hit them short little 10-yard passes and go deep occasionally. I got a feeling he's going to hit some new deep in this game for a touchdown. Right. Yeah, so I like the Patriots, but we're going to get back to that in the free play session. Patriots do what they do like they do every year. They win this game and they move on. Now we're jumping into Sunday's game, the NFC. Vikings at Saints. The Saints are 7.5. I think that's kind of a big number for a game like this. And I know why this number's so big, because the Vikings look so bad that game against Green Bay. And you know football is only, it's not what you done last week.
No.
You look as good as you looked last week, but it's not about that. 49.5. What do the Vikings have to do to steal this game and who that nation?
Well, they've been playing with adversity against them many times this year. To me, they play better on the road.
I'm kind of scared of this game, believe it or not, even though I know the Saints are moving on, but Jesus, this ain't going to be no easy game. No. Again,
I couldn't take the Saints to the point. Like I said, the Vikings have been playing good on the road. They've won a majority of their best games on the road. They beat your Cowboys on the road. They won more. They look better on the road this year. You saw against the Packers last week.
They look great against Seattle, though they didn't win that game.
Right, that game they could have won.
Yeah, easily.
So, I mean, they play better on the road to me than at home, which is an advantage a little bit because you have nothing to lose.
You
play with a nothing to lose attitude. And you never know. Cousins could play better on turf than he does in his own stadium. We'll find out. The Saints have been known for choking in the playoffs. Every year they have something they either complain about, either referees or a trick play. The ball goes over something. It's always something crazy with the Saints. They haven't been back at their Super Bowl in probably close to 8-9 years now. So I know they still want to do it, but 7.5 to me, I'm not laying that number.
Yeah, that's a big number. What the Vikings got to do is Cousins on some now you see me, now you don't.
Right.
I think he shows up this game. Okay. I think he shows up. I think he throws for his 250 plus yardage, gets about 2 touchdowns, but I think it just won't be enough at the end. But I think the Vikings will come out storming with that 7.5. They got a chip on their shoulder. They probably be leading the whole first half.
Okay.
Probably be a game like that. Now, for the Saints, ball control. Move the chains. Continue to get Thomas in the game. Cook in the game. They got to get something for Kamara. They have to get something from that guy, bro. He has to show up. This is where I think they're going to lose my boy. On the boy from Baltimore. What's his name again? My Ingram.
Ingram.
This is where I think they're going to feel the loss of Mark Ingram. You know what I'm saying? Ingram is huge. But if Kamara can step up and do anything what Ingram produced in the playoffs, they should prevail. I don't think they'll cover, but they will prevail. Okay, last game is Sunday. Seahawks at Eagles. 1.5 Seahawks, 45.5. What do the Hawks got to do to prevail?
Man, I mean, the Seahawks team won't die. They're always there. I mean, of course, with Russell Wilson and you got Pete Carroll running the ship, they're going to be there. They're in these playoffs pretty much every year. They've got weapons, but not the weapons that they've had, especially on offense.
Yeah, they lost Gordon. They lost Carson. Carson's big. I know they got beast mode, but he's not going to put, he's not going to put Carson numbers up.
So, I mean, it is hard because you don't have a real go-to receiver, I think. But you kind of do, but you
I would say.
I mean,
I say Metcalf is earning that.
He can't catch the ball. I mean, he doesn't have the same hands, but it's not like they got.
I think Metcalf is better than Gordon was right now. Not when Gordon came in the league, but as of right now,
he's okay. But
right, you don't like Metcalf?
No, but I mean, the Eagles are so decimated injury wise that
they got some people coming back though.
Yes, but it's still going to be tough. That's why it's pretty much a toss up of a game. That's why the line's so short.
Right.
It can go either way.
B. Israel, I'll see you, baby. Happy New Year.
Eagles have to utilize the fact that they have a home field in this game.
Right.
And use that to their advantage to win this game. I mean, the Philly fans got to come out crazy. This is their only representative.
What Seahawks need to do to win?
Russell Wilson has to just run the game. He needs to not get sacked, limit turnovers, and if he can get that run option, the RPO down, run pass option, they'll be fine because they have enough weapons to beat the Eagles because the Eagles are so decimated. But that's what the Seahawks have to do to win.
This is a funny game. That line is funny. 1.5. I would have made it 3.
Seahawks 3?
Yeah, I would have made Seahawks 3. Just to the fact that Russell Wilson and they got more people available than the Eagles do. But, you know, what Seahawks have to do, Russell has to play. He's got to show out. Russell Wilson has to show out. No ifs, buts about it. Play a Russell Wilson type of MVP type of game, and they can beat him. But I just think he's not going to have that type of game. And like I said, we're going to have our picks at the end of the show. But I just think that this is a funny game. Gun to my head, I'll have to run with the Eagles on that. Now, what the Eagles got to do to win? Same question.
Oh, man. Carson Wentz got to show up.
Yeah.
That's all. He got to show up. Because sometimes he out there looking like this is the guy that we're choosing over Nick Foles. This is the guy that's getting all that money.
Right.
I mean, to me, he's underachieved since he became the Masters. He got paid.
So yeah, I agree.
He's got to...
Yeah, two big games, right, though. But what that means is he don't show up now. Right. You know what I mean?
Get in. They got in. They got a home game in the playoffs. Crowd's going to be hyped. I mean, this is a... You know, they have low expectations, just like they did the year they won the Super Bowl. Nobody thought they would go... But that was with Nick Foles. So this is different because now Carson Wentz can actually show, yo, I'm the guy y'all picked over Nick Foles.
He has to show out, though.
So, I mean, it's a big game for him. It's probably the biggest game of his life.
No, he has to show out.
And he can't disappoint the fans or management that they gave him all that money.
Right. I think, like he said, Carson Wentz has to show out. No ifs, buts about it. And they got to put hands on Russell Wilson.
Right.
Yep. That defense has to put hands. They can't let Russell just go up and down the field and torture them. So if that happens, it'll be an easy win for the Seattle Seahawks this Sunday. Okay, let's move on. We took care of the NFL. Now we go on to the NCAAF championship game. Mm-hmm. LSU Tigers and the Clemson Tigers, who I picked out from the beginning. You still ain't give me my homage for that, but it's all good. The line is -5.5 for the Tigers. 69.5.
Both Tigers.
Both of them, yeah, LSU.
LSU Tigers.
LSU Tigers. Both of them 14-0 also. So they got a lot of things that match up. Both of them got two good quarterbacks also.
Right.
My question to you, what do the Tigers have to do to win the championship?
What do the LSU Tigers have to do to win?
Yeah, LSU Tigers.
Let's see. Just do what they've been doing. They haven't really, they've been tested, obviously. They have the, they, you know, they're in the toughest conference in college football. But they haven't really been in a close game. It's, I mean, they blow these teams out. You saw what they did to Oklahoma. They look. I mean, they had to wave the white flag, or it was really bad.
You know, I called that one, but I knew that Oklahoma couldn't mess with them, man.
I mean,
no defense.
It's hard not to take LSU here in so many ways. Every arrow, everything's pointing to LSU. Clemson hasn't played the amount of opponents as difficult as LSU's played. You got the Heisman Trophy winner, Joe Burrow, who's playing out of his mind, probably the first pick of the draft.
No, probably.
Trevor Lawrence.
Yeah, no problem. Let me correct you. He is.
Now, remember, Trevor Lawrence is going to be NFL quarterback, too. And you've seen what happened after that, I'm going to say, BS targeting call.
Right.
When he came out the game. And he came back, and he was able to, he had that vicious run down. I mean, that touchdown run was unbelievable for a quarterback to do that against
Ohio State. That showed us a lot, that they came back from a 16-0 deficit against the Ohio State Buckeyes, mm-hmm. who a lot of people picked to win it all. So that showed you that Clemson ain't lose a beat from last year. But God.
The only problem is they was out there like it was the last game of the season. They was nailing tooth, biting everything to win that game. It was came down to the wire, pretty much last possession. It was, a close game the whole way.
And Sweeney outcoached the guy from Ohio State.
So you put a lot more work into winning the game like that. And then you can't usually... You're like, oh, all right, now we got to play LSU. And they had a cakewalk. And they're going to be ready, rested, all that.
2 weeks, though. It's two weeks off.
Time. I know it is.
So they will be back. I don't think that's going to be an issue at all. I'm saying, but yeah, finish up and I'm going to give my perspective.
I'm just saying it's LSU has every advantage in the world. And that's why the line is 5.5 against a team that hasn't lost in 2 years.
Right.
Clemson has lost in 2 years and they're almost getting the touchdown. But it's because of what we just talked about, and because obviously everyone knows LSU is the better team on paper.
Right.
It's just, can they do it on the field in New Orleans that night?
Well, I just think Joe Burrow. Joe Burrow is probably the best quarterback I've seen in college since probably Dan Marino. Wow. You know what I mean? Joe Burrow is that good. I mean, he is that good. Now, don't get me wrong. You had a lot of great quarterbacks that can run. But I'm really talking about from the pocket.
He can
run
too, though.
No, I know that. He can definitely run, but I mean from the pocket. And if you add the running element, then that takes him to a whole other level. This is why I think Joe Burrow is going to be the most wanted guy. They're already talking, trading up for him. About mad teams want to trade up for him. Because at the end of the day, Cincinnati don't really know what to do with Dalton. Yeah. Because Dalton and me ain't finished. I think if you put them out there with the right squad, but that's another story. We'll talk about that another day. LSU, play defense. Get them off the field. Let Joe Burrow work his magic. They win easily. Easily. But if Clemson could get the Burrow and shake him up and maybe get him out the game, because I think it might be one of these games where they knock him out the game. They're going to have to knock him out the game.
Only way to beat him.
Yeah, because you let him sit back there, he's going to torture you. He makes all the throws. The short throw, the deep throw, the crossing throws. This guy's got a touch that I haven't seen in years. And for my boy LSU Johnny, your LSU Tigers will win this year. I don't know if they'll cover, but they'll win. I think LSU has too much. Now, what Clemson has to do to win, try to contain Joe Burrow. You're not going to stop him. You contain him. You don't let him have a blow-up game on you. Get him off the field when you need to. Trevor Lawrence got to play lights out. Lawrence plays lights out. They contain him. That's the method that they can beat them. But it hasn't happened all year. So I got the LSU Tigers winning the chip.
So the last time LSU was in this position as a favorite with a quarterback with all the hype in the world.
It was DeMarcus Russell?
Right.
And but that wasn't this type of game, though.
Everybody crowned him as he's going to be a beast in the NFL, this and that.
But he was always overweighted. That was the problem with him. He had like the Cole Pepper look.
So like Zion Williamson, too. He's overweight. Looks like he's overweight. But he got all this hype, too. So
yeah, but he might be a bust. We already spoke about not a bust. Not a bust. But he not might be as good as they say.
And Jamarcus Russell was definitely a bust with a capital B.
Yeah, capital.
He's at the buffet right now.
Capital. Z Rogers, I see you, baby. Yeah, so any last words you want to say?
We'll see if Burrow can keep it going because he pretty much had what one of my friends told me. He's had the perfect season pretty much. Hasn't had a hiccup. Hasn't had one blemish on his race. It's just been
You know why there hasn't been close games? I'm going to tell you why. Every time a team get close to them, Burrow cut them up.
Yeah, remember Alabama?
Yeah, he cut them right up. So when you make it 7-7, even Oklahoma made it 7-7.
And then boom,
cut them right up. That's why there's no close game. There's a reason for that madness. You know what I'm saying? Joe Burrow for president. All right.
2020.
All right. Now we're going to NFL coaches, right? I want to hear your take on Pat Shurmur. Not that there's much to say about him because he had a 9-23 record for the New York Football Giants. Sam Favors, I see you, baby. But going 9-23, we kind of knew he was getting booted. So I got two questions. What you thought of him real quick and who the Giants should look to take on to run that organization. Your take.
Let's get Tom Coughlin back.
Oh, wow. You want to get the general back in there?
What else can they do?
Get the general?
Yeah, he's gone from Jacksonville.
Oh, man, you get the general.
I don't know what direction they're going to go in. They got a long way to go. The good thing
what names are we hearing? I heard a few names.
Not really anything I'm really hearing. Because
Why they not talking Marvin Lewis?
No, I don't see that happening. No, I hope they don't get Marvin Lewis.
I mean, he's better than what they had.
Pat Shurmur. It's going to be tough because...
McCarthy's name's being rung up.
No, okay, yeah.
Yeah, McCarthy's name's being rung up. So yeah, he might not be a bad fit. He's an upgrade from Shurmur.
Danny Dimes, though. I mean,
McCarthy could do him like he did Rodgers in the beginning of their going.
Okay. That could be a name.
See what I'm saying?
They got, you know, obviously they'll figure it out eventually, but they've been going through this coaching carousel in New York since Coughlin left. So let's, you know, close the door with now. Who knows what happens? What I'm just waiting for is the ball to drop on Jason Garrett, which is who we're going to talk about now because that's your coach. I want to hear your take on if Jason Garrett will ever coach again.
Okay, can we do that after we knock these out?
I want to hear this now.
Can we leave that for the last coaches?
This is more important than Freddie Kitchens.
No. I just want to run through this, and then we're going to get to Garrett.
That'll
give you some time.
On your schedule.
So, like, you know, in my back of my head, I could come up with something. All right, Freddie Kitchens, 6-10, was a – I can't curse on the show no more, but he was an effing joke at Cleveland.
Disaster.
Arguing with guys on the field, wearing a shirt. What the shirt said?
You started it, we finished it or something.
Yeah, how do you do that as a head coach?
Yeah, not too
smart. I mean, if a defensive coordinator did that, I'm letting them go.
It was so bad. They even wanted, what's his name back? That was there that 2 years. I forgot his name, the coach that was with the Browns, and they finally got rid of him.
Yeah.
What was his name?
I forgot who you talking about.
Yeah, he was there 2 years with the Browns. He was,
right,
we
say his name.
0-30 or something. He finally won a game, and then they got rid of him and brought in Kitchens, and we want...
No, they don't want him. Jackson?
No.
Hugh Jackson? They don't want him back.
It was that bad with Freddie Kitchens. It was we had to deal with Hugh Jackson.
Right. Well, anyway, went 6-10. Question is, where do the Cleveland Browns go to now? You already know they got a good team on paper. They just need to get coached well. What kind of coach would fit all these attitudes?
I'm already hearing coaches turning down the Cleveland Browns out. They don't even want nothing to do with it. They don't want to interview.
Because they're all hot-headed for no reason.
And why would you want to be in front of a bad franchise like that that has a quarterback that's not proven, who has more commercials than wins?
Wow.
You got Odell Beckham, who's, you don't even know if he wants to play for this team anymore.
Landry.
It's just a train wreck over there in Cleveland. It's gonna take a miracle to even get this team. I mean, obviously they won 6 games, right? So that was better than winning 0.
I got a name for you.
Okay.
How about they put Coughlin over there? How about they put the general over there? Yo, if they put the general over there, I guarantee you he'd be finding each and every one of those guys. But they'll probably want out.
What about a name like Lincoln Riley?
Right.
He coached Baker for a year in Oklahoma. Right. I mean, I don't think Riley's going to stick around.
Yo, E, what up, baby? Happy New Year. Well, I think they need a veteran. I don't think they need a college guy.
Okay.
They need a veteran. The only thing is, who's really out there?
That's what I'm saying. I mean, Kingsbury.
I'm going to go back to Marvin Lewis. With Marvin Lewis, he'll be a way better fit than Kitchens. That's no doubt. But anybody. That's not saying
you
much.
You would be a better fit.
Yeah, that's not saying much.
Your wife would be a better fit.
Oh, wow. He said my wife don't even like sports.
But Kitchens is that bad. That's what I'm saying. Right. Kitchens should be in the kitchen cooking. Get your wife out of there. Get her on the sideline.
Fat ass self. But I think Marvin Lewis would be nice now. Get him going and then go get that guy.
I just don't know if Odell Beckham would respect. I mean, maybe Lewis would.
Yeah. Big Al. Love, baby. Much love, Al.
We'll find out, though. We'll see what the Browns do. Right now, it's a job nobody wants. So
right.
Until somebody actually says.
And it's sad because they got so much talent over there.
Yeah. It's hard.
But they in disarray, dogs. I mean, they argue.
They remind me of the Cowboys. You know? But they're a little bit younger.
Oh, that's the wow. Thing.
All that talent.
How about Miami Hurricanes in college? How about that?
Okay.
They remind me of the Canes in college. Okay. Always beefing. But at least the Canes were winning.
Right, that's the
and
difference.
They won chip with Jimmy Johnson, et cetera.
Big difference, right.
All right, so now we're going to go to Ron Rivera, a.k.a. Riverboat Ron. Just signed with the Washington Redskins. I heard his interview sounded real solid. I love the fact of the way he broke down how the boss went after him, recruited him, and I love what he's offering. He wants to make them grown men. He wants them to take on the community, look out for the community, and play football. That'd be perfect for the Cleveland Browns. But unfortunately, they ain't get Ron Rivera. Ron Rivera is also a proven winner. He's 76-63 with one tie in 9 seasons with the Carolina Panthers and also went to the chip when they lost to the Denver Broncos.
Yep.
Your take on Riverboat Ron taking over the Redskins?
Well, I heard the money was there. It was more than enough for Ron. It wasn't, you know, he didn't have to really.
He said it wasn't really about money because he could have got more money elsewhere.
I'm sure when.
No, but they offered him more money elsewhere is what I'm saying.
Right, but Dan Snyder wasn't going to let this slip.
He wanted it.
He wanted him.
Yeah, he wanted Ron Rivera, and he went and gave up some M's for him.
I mean, it was a disaster with Jay Gruden the last few years, so they were looking forward to changing that position, and they finally did. Rivera obviously has been there before. He's more of a, I don't want to say more of a new school type head coach, but he has old school and new school, a little bit of a mix of both. He has a little bit of analytics, but he also is a little old school. So we'll see.
I don't like his fire in the sideline.
No.
I just don't, man. Like, he just be standing there looking stupid. Like, you know, I understand he gambles. I understand that. Riverboat Ron, he'll go 4th-and-1 numerous times.
4th-and-5.
But my thing is, when they were struggling in Carolina, he was never able to make that adjustment. You got to be able to make adjustment. In-game adjustments is everything. That's why Floyd Mayweather is so great in boxing, of making in-game adjustments. Now, I know boxing and football is different, but you know exactly what I'm talking about.
Right.
Belichick's also a guy like that. If he sees you doing something to him, Belichick will flip it on you.
Right.
Send everybody wide, take away the run. You stack up against the pass, and he'll run the ball on you. Riverboat Ron, since him being so old school and really a defensive coordinator, never made that adjustment on an offensive tip, and that's why I think Cam Newton really struggled on top of him not bringing his A game.
Right.
Feel me? So now we're going to go. I'm not dodging your question. Ask it again.
I want to hear your take on why Jerry Jones still hasn't fired Jason Garrett. Why is he still the? He should have been fired at halftime.
Right.
Of that game against the New York or against the Redskins.
Redskins, they were blowing him out.
Yeah, but he still.
You mean
have
the
fired
Eagles?
No.
You mean the Eagles?
The Eagles, yeah. But he underperformed so. I mean, this guy is the only coach I've ever seen that gets so much rope and so much running every year. I keep thinking he's gonna be gone. He's going on 10 years.
Well, if you was a little older like me, Billy Martin got a lot of rope.
Right,
Billy Martin used to get fired, but then rehired.
And brought back.
Yeah, like three different times. So y'all who remember Billy Martin of the Yankees, y'all know what I'm talking about.
Of course.
But back to your question. Why he gets so much rope?
That and why hasn't been fired yet.
It's been one thing first. Jason Garrett is like a son of Jerry Jones.
Okay.
That's established. Jerry Jones loves everything about Jason Garrett except that he can't get them to win,
which is huge.
That's why, from my understanding, they fired the whole staff but him. So he's in his third meeting with the Joneses.
That's what I heard.
My understanding is they're going to move him down. They're going to keep him in the organization but take him off head coaching. That's what I'm thinking they're going to do with him.
So a coordinator?
No, I don't even know if he's going to probably be on the football field. They might use him as a consultant or something.
Mascot?
Not no mascot. But he'll be in the organization where he'll be in that room when it comes to draft choices and all of that.
Okay.
But Jerry Jones and Stephen Jones, they have to get him out of that spot. They are puppering this dude.
It's been five
First of
days.
All, he ain't even eligible to run the game like the way he wants it.
Mm-hmm.
Do you even know Jerry Jones stripped him of play calling got Kellen Moore to do it?
That's
a guy that had no experience in the NFL? Okay. How do you expect that to work? So I think Jason Garrett will be gone as a head coach, but he'll be in the organization still.
All right.
Are you satisfied with that answer?
I guess so, but who's the kind of guy we bring in now? Is it we bringing a Wade Phillips type guy, or you bringing a Bill Parcells type guy?
You're going to be crazy when I tell you this.
Don't say Urban Meyer.
Yes, I want Urban Meyer, dog.
Come on.
I want Urban Meyer. Jerry Jones got to track Urban Meyer down and tell him, listen, man, get off that network, that NFL, whatever he is, college network. Come do what you do best.
He's going to try to run the team.
Come coach. Well, he's going to have to let him.
Jerry don't let nobody.
He's going to have to let him. But Jerry got to know that what he's been doing for 20-something years have not been working. And the only reason why he won those chips is because of Jimmy Johnson and Barry Switzer. And after that, he just started feeling like taking more control of stuff.
Right.
And that's when everything went downhill from there on out. He has to be smart enough to know that.
Okay.
And he's too old right now. He just needs to fall back, get on some Robert Kraft shit, just fall back and let them do what they need to do. Let them do the food shopping, the cooking, etc. Jerry Jones, you need to fall back. If you're listening to me, fall back. Let a coach run everything.
So be like Al
You're
Davis.
Not a head coach. Yeah, Al Davis is another one. I mean, rest in peace to Big Al. Just win. And Al won a couple chips over there with Madden, et cetera. But he also fell off late in his career because of that, you know, that power struggle.
Mm-hmm.
And Jerry Jones has to relinquish that. He has to. Any more you want on that? Or I gave you enough?
No, that's good enough. I just wanted to make sure you were not going to say he's coming back for another year.
I wouldn't be surprised. I hope not. Being my team, and that's another thing. I always represent my team, win or lose. Y'all need to stop doing that. A lot of y'all come out to sewage when your team is winning. I'm representing my team, and we had a horrible year. What was it? 7-9, 8-8?
7-9.
No, I think we didn't close out 8-8. I think we closed out
8-8. 8-8, yeah.
Still underachieved tremendously, and I'm repping my team. Y'all need to start doing that. Real
it
talk.
It blow out a lot of teams that were under 500, though.
That's why. It'd be like one 500 team that was over 500.
That's it.
Okay, I want to also give out a special rest in peace to Sam Weiss. He used to coach the Cincinnati Bengals. He took them to the chip. He died at 74 right. years old today. And as of yesterday, David Stern, ex-NBA commissioner, who was a commissioner 30-plus years in the NBA, passed away. So rest in peace to these two individuals. Any take on David Stern? Because he was something else.
He did a lot. He brought the game international.
Right.
He brought it from where it was not as, you know, hectic as it is now. Now it's a 12-month, 24-hour-a-day season. Where there's not really an off season in the NBA anymore. And I understand our current commissioner is doing a lot of that, has brought a lot of that to what it is now.
The current one's more like a player commissioner, right, which
but
I
David
like.
Stern was, he made sure this was going to happen this way, he made sure it was going to happen that way. And he got it
and
done.
Very controversial. A lot of people didn't like a lot of moves
he got
that he did.
All the time.
Yeah, you know, he one of those guys, but he stood by what he did. Obviously, he turned the NBA, took the NBA to a whole other level. 30 plus years, the longest tenure commissioner also.
Right.
So you got, and he's also in the Hall of Fame, by the way.
Right.
He got inducted in 2014. Salute and rest in peace to David Stern. Real fast, time is going, we're unlimited. We're going to have to go to free picks real fast eventually. But before the free pick, J.J. Watt is back. What you expect from him? We mentioned him earlier. Real fast, what do you expect from him?
I expect him just to come out and kind of do a Willis read. Maybe get a tackle here and there. I don't think he's up to game speed yet, which is hard to get to in football more than any other sport. But he will definitely be a jolt of electricity to the crowd and the rest of the team.
Right. J.J. Watt, just his presence alone. Showing up in that Houston Texans stadium, it's going to light the whole. It's going to light up the whole stadium.
Oh, yeah.
Especially like I said, if he makes a sack or any big play, salute to him for coming back because with that injury he had was a pectoral muscle, something like that. He tore it up, came back way sooner than expected, and he's a little older.
Oh, yeah.
He ain't young no more. So salute to Watt for making it happen, getting back, and hopefully he can lead his team. I know I don't mean to say hopefully to you because you're a Buffalo Bill fan, but I got them on the teaser. That's why I said that. Salute to J.J. Watt. Now, real quick, we got 10 minutes for the free picks.
Okay.
Now, I want you to start with the team that you like this week, and then I'm going to finish off with the last two and give reasoning.
Okay.
We talked to them real quick.
About
29 and 22 going into this week.
Talked about this game earlier. This is a playoff matchup that's going to be on Sunday. NFC matchup. Seahawks -1.5 against the Philadelphia Eagles in Philly. Now, every time you see a team favorite on the road in the playoffs, it's always kind of, wait a minute, what? And it is kind of a weird line, okay? You look at it, it was 2, now it's down to 1.5. I've seen some ones, it's still 1.5 for most places.
What line you would have made it? What Noah Parker would have made that
I would have. I personally would have made the line a pick 'em.
Wow, I would have said at least 2.5 for the Seahawks.
No, I would have made it a pick 'em because
they've been the better team.
They have been the better team, but being at home in a playoff game is huge.
Remember, Seahawks won every game on the road except that Ram game that they forgot to show up.
Right.
Beside that, they're another team that played better on the road than at home. But go ahead.
But I just think that it's just a make or break game for Carson Wentz.
It means more to the Eagles than Wentz.
I mean, obviously it means a lot for the Seahawks.
No, both sides. But I think it means more for the Eagles, especially
first,
Wentz.
The Seahawks, they relish coming back in games and playing well in the fourth quarters. They start off so slow. They did it again last week to the Niners. Started off looking just horrible. And if they do that against the Eagles, it might
be a wrap.
Yeah, because the Eagles have been battle-tested. They've been to the Super Bowl recently. I mean, they've won the Super Bowl recently.
Peterson got them playing with that right. Extra step, too, right now, last couple
exactly.
Games.
Exactly. So, I don't know. I just think that the weather's an advantage, the cold weather, the fans, all that, the travel, everything points in the direction of why I think it should be a pick 'em, and that's why I think the Eagles have a little bit of an advantage. I'm saying take the Eagles plus the 1.5 for money line them if you want, and the Eagles win this game outright against the Seattle Seahawks.
When am I right? Well, I'm going to agree with you. I think it's a funny line to me. I think it should be 2.5. I know everybody's going in there pounding Russell Wilson.
Of course.
I don't like that. I don't like when the scale's like this. I go with the bottom for some
reason. I think
the
Eagles have a little bit more momentum right now, too. Not
yeah.
Just because of last week, but...
On paper, Seattle's the better team,
right.
But I think the Eagles prevail
in
a real ugly game.
It's
I think
more
it's
about...
An under, too. I like an under in that game.
Right. In the playoffs, you see more teams, you know, they go in with momentum.
Right.
They do better. The Seahawks kind of, sputtered in.
Yeah.
Eagles are coming off some good wins to end the season. They've looked bad most parts of this year, but... They're actually starting to look like they're righting the ship a little bit. Give me the Eagles at home plus the points.
Right, okay. So that's our first pick on the Al York Sports Show, Eagles. Game two, I'm not really surprised, y'all, but we're going to go with the New England Patriots first half, -2.5, -3, whatever number you can get. Don't go higher than 3. 3, 2.5, I just think all the disarray that's been going around Tom Brady, Bill Belichick, this is what the New England Patriots live for, and they know They got to come out the gate in this game.
Have to.
They do not want to be trailing the Titans where the Titans could just run, run, and run Derrick Henry the whole game. Because that will wear that defense down.
Oh, yeah.
That slow down tremendously late in the season. Brady and them need to get up early, try to get Henry out the game, and let Tannehill beat them, which I don't see that. And I think New England gets up early, maybe 14-10, 14-7-ish, 17-7-ish. First half, New England minus three. Your take?
I agree. I think the same thing. Patriots, Foxborough is going to be jumping. This is the time of year they live for. Could be the last run for Tom Brady and Belichick. I think they show out.
Okay, that's what's up. Now, the last pick is a two-team, seven-point teaser, which what's the percentage more or less you said about?
What do you mean, the juice you got to pay?
No, the percentage on my teasers.
Oh, about 90%.
Now you went to 90? 90%. I say 85. Doesn't mean I can't lose, though. I got two teasers. I'm going to keep it strictly in Louisiana. My boy Johnny Football is going to love me for this. We're going to take the Saints down from 7.5 down to a half.
So basically a win.
They just got to win. It's not going to be pretty. I'm going to tell y'all right now. A lot of y'all might say I'm lucky. Saints kind of have to make it to the chip this year. Last year, I thought was the last run. They got cheated on that play. Everybody knows that. Even though they still could have won the game in multiple ways. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, that call gets made a win. That's bottom line. My thing is, you got to prevent that from happening. How you prevent that from happening? You light them up out the gate. And if Cousins has any type of bad game, throws any picks, they win easily. I think it's going to be a close game, 28-24-ish, 27-23, you know what I mean?
Right.
Like the Saints in this one. And in the second game, I normally don't go across the number. We're going to take the LSU Tigers from -5.5 to +1.5, which is basically like a pick'em, but if they lose by one, you still win the ticket.
Right.
So that's your two-team seven-point teaser, Saints -0.5, LSU +1.5. Y'all need to do your thing. Y'all need to get these plays in. We've been proving that we can win. We're trying to help y'all win. We're showing y'all. Ain't no game. Ain't no we told y'all we won after the game and we talking smack. No. We give y'all out every time before the game. Am I right or wrong? So you ain't going to get it more real than this. And with that, thank you guys for tuning in. Happy New Year. Say what you got to say before I close it out, brother.
All right, y'all. Share the video. Happy New Year. All the likes out there, the comments, all that. Make sure you keep supporting the Al York Sports Show.
With Noah Park.
And, it's going to be another great year. Just remember that. Another great decade, another great year. Started off right.
2020, baby.
Stay focused.
This is our year.
Stay focused.
Stay focused. Continue. We're going to continue to prove who we be. Just support us when we prove who we be. Douglas Bender, you're going to have to watch the rewind, brother. But thank you for tuning in. We love y'all. Happy New Year. Stay safe. And don't be afraid to tell your friend, your family, or anybody that's been significant in your life that you love them. You see me do it with my boy. He did it back. It doesn't make you less of a man. And with that, we love y'all. Thanks for tuning in to the Al York Sports Show with Noah Parker. Love, y'all. 100, baby.